First, let me say thank you for letting me share my story with you tonight. But let me preface this with, when I get nervous, sometimes I cry. And it's kind of an emotional, not kind of, it's a very emotional story for me anyway, so you aren't allowed to cry. If you don't cry, maybe I won't cry, and it will be much better, right? Okay. I spent a lot of time thinking about what I wanted to say tonight, and I think the hardest part has been trying to figure out where to begin, where my faith journey begins. I thought back on my childhood, growing up, going to church, but when it really comes down to it, there was one day in particular that changed the course of my life forever. But before I get to that, let me give you a little background as to how I got to that day. Jeff and I both joined the Air Force right out of high school and met in technical training school, which is where you go after basic training to learn your Air Force job. We only dated for about a month and a half, and then I was sent to my first duty station in Guam, while he went to his in Alaska. We did the long distance thing for a while, but it didn't take long to realize we wanted to be together for the long haul. So on April 1st, 1999, at 19 years old, we got married in a courthouse on Guam. 2 months after we got married, I got reassigned to Alaska, and we were so excited to finally be together. We both started working towards commissioning programs to become officers, but when he got accepted into pilot training, I knew it would be really hard to be stationed together. So I set my career aside and separated from the Air Force in order to follow him and support his career. A decision I never regretted. In the spring of 2003, we PCS'd to Valdosta, Georgia, where Jeff flew the T-6 in initial phase of pilot training. At 6 months later, we moved to Columbus, Mississippi for the next phase, and he flew the T-1. And at the end of T-1 training is when all the students get their operational assignments. So you get a list of all the planes and the places you can go, and then you rank them in order of what you want. The only plane Jeff ever wanted to fly was the C-17, so that was our top choice. But when our assignment night came, he ended up getting our last choice on the list. He was chosen to stay at Columbus to become an instructor to incoming students. Now, in retrospect, it was definitely the best assignment for us at that time, but in the moment, we were devastated. Columbus is pretty much in the middle of nowhere, Mississippi, and there wasn't really much more than a Walmart. So it's not the ideal location. But his instructors thought very highly of him and wanted to keep him around. So again, in retrospect, it was a great assignment. Jeff was an incredible instructor. But even more than that, we had our two boys there. And with no deployments and minimal temporary duty trainings, we were able to have 3 solid years of quality family time, which is something you don't get a lot of when you're serving in the military. I also worked as the accountant at the chapel on base and played piano for all the worship services there, which is a little note that'll be important later on. Write that down. When it was time for us to move on from Mississippi, Jeff was hoping and praying for one assignment, C-17s to Alaska. And neither of us could believe it when that assignment came through. It truly was his dream assignment, and we were so excited. We got back to Alaska in June of 2008, and things couldn't have been better. We were enjoying taking the boys camping, four-wheeling, snow machining, and all of that fun Alaskan stuff. He was doing awesome in the C-17, kicking butt and taking names. In the summer of 2010, TJ turned 5 in June, and Tyler turned 3 on July 25th. 3 days later, on July 28th, Jeff called me around 5:30 that night to tell me they were stepping to fly. He said they were gonna knock the flight out real quick and he'd be home after dinner. I told him I loved him and to fly safe, like I always did. No big deal, just another day, another flight. About 45 minutes later, At 6:14 p.m., the C-17 Jeff was flying in crashed on Elmendorf Air Force Base, killing all four crew members on board, including my husband. In an instant, I went from a military spouse to a military widow and a single mom to 3 and 5-year-old little boys. I was 31 years old, and I knew that my life would never be the same again. And that was the moment my true faith journey began. So in the early days and weeks after an accident like that, everybody wants answers. They want to know why. You want to know why, but unfortunately, there just aren't a whole lot of answers. A lot of questions, very few answers. And when there aren't answers available, people want to give you, as the one grieving, something to hang on to. They want something to make you feel better. So they would tell me, everything happens for a reason. We've all heard it, right? Everything happens for a reason. I can't even begin to tell you how many times I heard people tell that to me. But what I can tell you is that each time I heard it, I could feel my blood start to boil. And I so badly wanted to say, it's easy for you to say. It wasn't your husband in that airplane. Now, even though I hated it, and still do, when people say that to me, in my heart, I believed it was true. So you've also heard about after death or a tragedy like this, people tend to either cling to their faith or push it away. I found myself clinging to a faith that I didn't even necessarily knew that I had. From the very beginning, I believed that there was a reason. I believed that God had a plan. Because there had to be a purpose for Jeff's death. Things don't just happen, right? My healthy, happy, 31-year-old husband didn't die just because. There had to be a reason. Otherwise, what is the purpose of anything that we do here? And what do you do when you have two little boys asking you, why did my daddy have to die? That is one that really gets you, clearly. They asked me that question a number of times, and I remember telling them, I don't know. I don't know. I don't know why it had to be your dad. But what I do know is that God had a plan. He has a plan for us, and he had a plan for your dad. None of us know what that plan is. We don't always have to like the plan, but what we do have to do is trust it. I like to think that the job Jeff is doing in heaven is more important than the one he was doing here, because again, it gives his death purpose. And if he's up there helping the big guy, then I'm okay with that. Now, in the months following Jeff's accident, I started asking a lot of questions about God, faith, reincarnation, the journey of the soul, all that kind of stuff. While I believe God had a plan and that things happened for a reason, there wasn't really much else that I was sure of, so I was curious. I started talking to anyone and everyone that would listen. Some people thought I was crazy. Some thought I was just submerged in my grief. But then others took the time to really sit with me and talk about these things that I had rolling through my mind. One such person was a friend named Daniel. Now, before I go further about Daniel, let me explain how I know him. Daniel was in Jeff's initial pilot training class in Georgia, so 7 years before. After Georgia, we all went our separate ways as Daniel went to Texas for the second phase and we went to Mississippi. But in 2008, we found ourselves all back together again as he was also flying C-17s in Alaska. Daniel also later became my FLO. So you're probably wondering what a FLO is, right? Well, when there's an active duty death, the military assigns the family a person to help with all those official things that need to be done, filling out paperwork, decisions, all that kind of stuff. The Army calls this person a casualty assistance officer. The kindler, gentler Air Force calls it the family liaison officer, FLO for short. So this was Daniel. But Daniel was so much more than a FLO. He was official when he needed to be. He was a friend when I needed one. He was the person I trusted to help me make extremely difficult decisions, including picking out Jeff's urn. And he was also the one that I often turned to when I had questions about my faith. So fast forward about 2 years to a time when the boys and I were visiting Daniel and his wife, Cynthia, who were now in Colorado. And late one night, Cynthia and I had a conversation, just the two of us, in which she asked me, "Where are you in your walk with God?" I told her that I very much believe that everything happens for a reason, but I was having a harder time with the idea that if God truly loves me, why do I have to go through this? Why did it have to be my husband? If God loves us, isn't he supposed to take care of us and protect us? I don't get it. Remember, she nodded in understanding and said, "I will continue to pray that God shows you how he loves you." I was kind of taken back because I expected her response to be more of a speech telling me how God loves everyone and yada yada. But instead, all she said was she was going to pray. So 2 nights later, we had the exact same conversation, but this time Daniel was in the room. And he asked me the exact same question, "Where are you in your walk with God?" And again, I responded saying that I very much believe everything happens for a reason. What I have a hard time with is understanding that if God truly loves me, why is he making me go through this? Daniel then asked if I had ever heard his testimonial, and when I said no, he began to tell me a story about how God had changed his heart in preparation for something that was coming. He started by saying that in the summer before Jeff's accident, he was sitting in church and felt a physical jolt to the point where he had to leave the service and sit in his car to try to figure out what had happened. It was in that moment that he realized he needed to confess something to his family. Now, I'm not going to go into all the details, but just know that it was something very difficult for him. After the confession, he wasn't sure what was going to happen with his relationships. It was a very difficult time. From there, a few other things happened throughout the year that continued to be a challenge for him. Then on July 28th, he not only lost 4 coworkers, but he also lost a very close friend in Jeff. When it came time to selecting a flow for me, the squadron actually called Daniel and asked if he had any suggestions. And when he hung up the phone, Cynthia said to him, "If they can't find anyone, I think you should do it." Now, protocol says the flow is supposed to be someone who's not emotionally connected to the family or the person who has died. However, when they started asking me about potential flows, I was kind of shooting down all of their suggestions. But as the story goes, when they suggested Daniel, I am told that my face lit up, and that was the end of the discussion. So in the end of Daniel's story, he explained to me that before the events of that year unfolded, he didn't think he could have ever been anyone's flow, let alone my flow. Now, let me explain. He was with me all day, every day, for a long time. He went through everything that a family goes through, which is why he said he didn't know if he could have been anyone's flow, let alone mine. But it was through the events of that year that God had prepared his heart to be able to be there for me and for the boys. And it was in that moment that I started to cry. And I cried, much like I am now, because it was an almost immediate realization that having to go through this extreme grief and the loss of my husband is not because God doesn't love me. Instead, it is because God loves me, that he prepared the hearts of all of these people around me so that they could be there for me and my boys in a way that he knew we would need. That in itself is a pretty incredible realization. And the thing is, Daniel wasn't the only person that God prepared either, which is what makes it even more incredible for me. It actually started with me. I had thoughts for about 6 months that something was going to happen to him. And so when the phone call came that night, I remember hanging up the phone, taking a deep breath, and thinking, okay, here we go. I have a ton more stories, but I don't have a time for all of them, but I'm just going to share a couple more. Okay? So as I mentioned before, we were stationed in Mississippi. I worked at the chapel on base, and therefore knew all of the chaplains there very well. Like many churches, we were our own family and spent a lot of time together. And when Jeff and I transferred back to Alaska, the squadron there wanted all of the spouses to fill out a form that specified what we wanted if the unthinkable happened. We were supposed to fill out a sheet designating people for things like who we wanted to notify us, if there was someone we didn't want there, that type of thing. The one that jumped out at me, though, was the chaplain. I remember thinking, I don't know any of the chaplains here, so some random guy is going to come to my house and try and comfort me. I shook my head at the thought of it and never filled out the form. I just tossed it to the side. So on the night of the accident, I got a call around 7:30 from the squadron commander. He said, Jeff's been involved in an accident, but we don't know anything yet because the scene is still unsafe. I'm coming to your house with my wife. Colonel Weeks is coming with his wife. Colonel Gates is coming with his wife and the first sergeant. The only thing I said in response was, are you bringing a chaplain? He told me yes. I said, okay, thank you. And I hung up the phone. That was it. To be honest, I don't even know why I asked you about the chaplain. From working in the chapel, I knew that a chaplain is required to be there when they give notification. But in my mind, I hadn't even gotten there yet. Regardless, I asked, and it was definitely on my mind, and I knew that the chaplain was on his way to my house with this group from the squadron. So when they got to my house, they came in as a group, and then all stood as a group, kind of in a half circle in front of me, as the commander came and gave me the same speech as he did on the phone. Jeff has been involved in an accident, but we don't know anything yet because the scene is still unsafe, but it doesn't look good. At that point, I stopped listening. I didn't want to hear what he had to say. So I started looking at all the people that had just arrived at my house. I looked at the chaplain and I said, hey, you look familiar. I remember looking at him and he looked at me kind of startled, like, whoa, she's supposed to be listening to what's going on. Why is she talking to me? And I looked at his name tag. Mushinsky is not a very common name. And so I knew right away who he was. And I told him, I know you. You did our marriage counseling 10 years ago here in Alaska. I said, I even have your business card. And I left. I went to go get my scrapbook because I was going to show him that I still had his business card. And I left everybody just kind of standing in the living room. I don't know what they did when I left, but I came back and they had made themselves comfortable. So I sat next to the chaplain and I showed him his business card from 10 years before. And we sat and chatted about where we had been in those past 10 years. And it was like seeing an old friend again, comfortable and supportive. So in my night of uncertainty and devastation, God sent me a chaplain that was part of not only my life, because I had worked with him quite a bit when I was on active duty, but he sent me a chaplain that had been a part of mine and Jeff's, and that he was the one that did our marriage counseling. I didn't even know that I knew any chaplains at Elmendorf, but yet here he came walking to my house on the worst night of my life. He ended up being one of my biggest comforts, not only in that first night, but also in the following months, because he became my ultimate counselor. Anytime I felt I needed to talk to someone, he would drop everything for me, and we would talk for hours on end, often about God. So this is just my side of the story, but his side makes it even better, I think. I had Chaplain Mushinsky do Jeff's memorial service in Alaska, and this was the first story that he shared at his memorial service. And he said that As the head chaplain, he wasn't the one that was supposed to be going to the house of the family. But when the commander called and said they needed a chaplain, now he was the only one there. So he had to go. He said the whole way to my house, he was in the back seat thinking about all the things that he should be doing in the office. Paperwork, organizing, getting things ready. A lot had just happened in the past few hours. So he had a lot to do. But he couldn't say no. They were coming, and they needed a chaplain. He said that when I looked at him in my living room and told him he had done our marriage counseling 10 years before, it was immediately clear that this was where he was supposed to be. One more story that I want to share is about a friend that came into my life 6 months before Jeff died. Jeff and I bought the boys a mini snow machine for Christmas that year before, and Jeff made a track for them in the back of the neighborhood, so he would often take them back there and they would just kind of tootle around. It was usually just their thing, but every once in a while I would go back with them. And I swear, each time I went back there, I would just be kind of standing around watching, and this woman would come busting out of the woods with her two dogs. And each time, we would share small talk. You know, we shared our names, and she told me my boys were really cute, and I noticed she had an F-15 on her hat one time, and commented on that, and said Jeff had worked on F-15s. She said her husband was an F-15 pilot. I thought it was a fun coincidence, but yet not too odd, as it was a military town. But I only met her a few times in the back of the neighborhood, so I knew she lived close, but I never really saw her again after that. After Jeff's accident, I had some friends tell me I needed to talk to this girl, Lindsay. They explained to me how she had lost her first husband in a plane crash in Iraq, and her new husband was an F-15 pilot. And they kept assuring me, you know her. She's in your neighborhood. Her name is Lindsay. And they kept going on and on. And I'm like, guys, I have no idea who you're talking about. No idea. And then one day, it hit me. Lindsay was the woman I met in the back of the neighborhood walking her dogs. And again, we only met a few times, but that was all it took. And once I realized I knew who they were talking about, they gave her my phone number, and we chatted a few times on the phone, since at this point they had moved out of Alaska. We talked once early on, and then again after a year or so. But even though it was only a handful of conversations, she made a huge impact on me. Because at this point, I think it had been about 5 years since Lindsay's husband had died. And like I said before, she had since remarried. But what made the biggest impact on me was that she was happy. In those conversations, when I was feeling so low in my grief and just missing my husband, she showed me that happiness after a death like that was not only possible, but that it was okay. She probably has no idea the kind of impact she's made on me, but God put her in my life for a reason. And his message came through loud and clear. So this summer we celebrated Jeff's 5-year angelversary, and I say celebrated because instead of mourning his death, we choose to celebrate his life. And around that time I got a tattoo on my wrist that says, "Choose joy." So I wear a memorial bracelet on one side, and on the other side it says, "Choose joy." At first it was weird. I felt like I was all tatted up or something. But now that it's been there for a while, I find myself looking at it every now and then, and especially in times when I'm feeling really down. In many ways, I think happiness is a choice. At least my happiness is a choice. I can choose to live a sad and depressing life, because my life's events haven't exactly gone the way I had planned. Or I can choose to take the path God has put me on with grace and find the joy in the little things along the way. I personally choose the joy. Sometimes it may take a little digging to find, but that joy is always there. So before I go, I'm going to show you a couple of pictures that I see have been up here already, but I'll explain who they are. So this is Daniel and me. This is after Jeff's burial at Arlington National Cemetery. And the original picture I wanted to show you was one of me sitting by myself after everyone had left. And I had no idea, but Daniel was standing behind me. Nobody was there except for Daniel. And I think it is the perfect representation of the strength that he has been for me. And again, I could not have gotten through it without him. So the fact that God prepared him to be in my life at that time, in that capacity, it's pretty amazing. So that's Daniel, and then the other one is Jeff. And then finally, we're gonna play a song. So this song, after the accident, people would send me all kinds of things. People send you everything, food, flowers, but they also sent me songs. I would usually purchase them on iTunes and then put them on my phone to listen to later when I had time to actually listen to the words. This was one of those songs, and I vividly remember the night that I first heard it. It was fairly early on after Jeff's death, and it was probably about 2 a.m. or something like that because I couldn't sleep. All of the lights were off, but I had the fire going, and I was laying on the couch with my phone on my chest, shuffling songs, and this song came on at random. I was crying and talking out loud to Jeff or God or whoever was listening. I didn't know. I was talking about how much I missed him, and I didn't know how I could do this on my own. I wanted a sign. I needed a sign. I needed something to tell me that I wasn't alone. And that is when this song came on. It's called Blessings. And it is through this song that I realized that Jeff's death, as terrible as it was, gave me the incredible perspective to be able to take a step back and see some of the incredible ways that God has worked in my life. I have so many more stories, and I wish I could share them all with you, but being able to have that perspective and see how all of these little pieces of the puzzle fit together in one giant way is just incredible. So these are the blessings that I feel like I am able to see and feel in terms of my faith. So I can't say Jeff's death was a blessing, because Lord knows I wish I could have him back. But these things that I can see and feel in my faith, I feel are the blessings as a result of his death. So my true blessing is this new relationship I have with God. So as we listen to the song, and I think the words are going to be up there, just listen to it and let the words speak to you. Thank you.
We pray for blessings, we pray for peace, comfort for family, protection while we sleep. We pray for healing, for prosperity. We pray for your mighty hand to ease our suffering. And all the while, you hear each spoken need. Yet love is way too much to give us lesser things. 'Cause what if your blessings come through raindrops? What if your healing comes through tears? What if a thousand sleepless nights are what it takes to know you're near? What if trials of this life are your mercies in disguise? Pray for wisdom, your voice. to hear. And we cry in anger when we cannot feel you near. We doubt your goodness, we doubt your love, as if every promise from your word is not enough. And all the while you hear each desperate plea, and long that we'd have faith to believe. 'Cause what if your blessings come through raindrops? What if your healing comes through tears? And what if a thousand sleepless nights are what it takes to know you're near? And what if trials of this life are your mercies in disguise? When friends betray us, when darkness seems to win, we know the pain reminds this heart that this is not life, the rain, the storms, the hardest nights, all your mercies in disguise.